Coffin problems are some of the hardest yet fascinating math problems given to mainly Jewish students at Soviet universities in Soviet Union during the late 1970s. They are designed to be really hard, which their solutions are nearly impossible to find but comprise of purely elementary solutions. In this video, we will be solving two of the Coffin problems, which one of them is on prime numbers and another problem is on functional inequality. So buckle up and let's get started with the problems. The first problem starts by letting pi be the I prime number. Then we take the product of the first n prime numbers, which are p1, p2 up to pn. Then I want you to show that it is less than 4 to the power of pn for all natural numbers n. Can you prove this inequality? If you want to give this problem a try, you can pause the video now, and after you have tried, continue watching the video for the solutions. To prove this inequality, notice that we are dealing with the sequence of prime numbers, from the first prime number to the n prime number. And because they are ordered in natural numbers 1 to n, it would be tempting to use induction. And yes, we will in fact use strong induction to prove this. And we can do this by inducting on the n prime. For the base case, we check that this inequality clearly holds, as p1 is equal to 2, and 2 is less than 4 to the power of 2, which is 16. This is the first step for induction proofs. Then for our inductive hypothesis, we first assume that this inequality holds for all k less than or equal to n, meaning that the product of p1, p2 up to pk is less than 4 to the power of pk, whenever k is less than or equal to n. Then we shall prove that this inequality also holds for the case n plus 1. That is, we want to show that the product of p1, p2 up to p of n plus 1 is less than 4 to the power of pn plus 1. And here, I'm going to let pn plus 1 to be equal to 2n plus 1, where n is a natural number, and note that because pn plus 1 is odd, it is possible to write it in this form. Then I will now set j such that p1, p2 up to pj are all less than or equal to n plus 1. And n plus 2 is less than or equal to pj plus 1, pj plus 2, up until to pn plus 1, and they are all less than or equal to 2n plus 1. It may become clear later on why we split the prime numbers into two sequences of prime numbers. Another thing to note is that the attempt to induct directly from n to n plus 1 is entirely naive and not useful, as the inequality that we end up trying to prove is not true in general. That is, pn plus 1 may not be less than p to the power of pn plus 1 minus pn. So back to our solution, let us now split the product of prime numbers from p1 to pn plus 1 into two parts. The first part is from p1 to pj, and the second part is from pj plus 1 to pn plus 1. Then we can use the inductive hypothesis to bound the first part of the product, which is less than p to the power of pj. Then we now focus on the second part, and this is where it gets beautiful. I claim that the primes pj plus 1, pj plus 2, up until to pn plus 1, which are greater than or equal to n plus 2 and less than or equal to 2n plus 1, must all divide the value 2n plus 1 choose m. And the way that we are going to prove this is actually quite simple. Notice that 2n plus 1 choose m can be written out in this form, where the numerator is the descending product of m terms and m factorial in the denominator. Notice that the terms in the descending product in the numerator start at 2n plus 1 and end at n plus 2, which are exactly the bounds of the prime numbers pj plus 1 to pn plus 1. So they must be contained somewhere in the descending product. And then the prime factors of n factorial do not cancel with any prime factor greater than n plus 1 in the numerator, which means that the primes pj plus 1 to pn plus 1 will not be cancelled out when we reduce the fraction, as they are all greater than or equal to n plus 2. Hence, this also means that pj plus 1, pj plus 2, up to pm plus 1, must all divide the value 2m plus 1, choose m. This actually gives us a bound, which is the product of pj plus 1, pj plus 2, up until to pm plus 1, is less than or equal to 2m plus 1, choose m. And this is the key to solving this problem. Now, to get the inequality that we want to prove, we actually try and show that 2m plus 1 choose m is less than 4 to the power of m. To prove this, consider the quantity 2m plus 1 choose m plus 2m plus 1 choose m plus 1. It is the same as twice the quantity 2m plus 1 choose m by the property of binomial coefficient. Then it is clearly less than the sum of all binomial coefficients 2m plus 1 choose I, where I runs from 0 to 2m plus 1. But I guess it is pretty well known that the sum of 2m plus 1 binomial coefficients is actually the binomial expansion of 1 plus x to the power of 2m plus 1 evaluated at x is equal to 1. So it is the same as 1 plus 1 to the power of 2m plus 1. Therefore, twice the quantity 2m plus 1 choose m is less than 2 to the power of 2m plus 1. Dividing by 2, we get 2m plus 1 choose m is less than 2 to the power of 2m, which is 4 to the power of m. And this is actually the last piece of information that we need, because previously the product of the first j prime numbers is less than p to the power of pj, where we use the inductive hypothesis, and the second part of the product is then shown to be less than 4 to the power of m. But notice that pj is less than or equal to m plus 1. So this actually means that the product of the first m plus 1 prime numbers is less than 4 to the power of m plus 1 times 4 to the power of m, which is 4 to the power of 2m plus 1. And since 2m plus 1 is equal to pm plus 1, it is also less than 4 to the power of pm plus 1. This completes our inductive step, thus proving the desired inequality for all natural numbers n. So I think this is actually a hard and interesting number theory problem, since it relates to the distribution and the properties of prime numbers, which is of the interest of modern number theory research too. In particular, I really like how we can actually bound the size of the product of the first n prime numbers, since I think it gives us a sense of how prime numbers grow. Now let's solve the second problem. We want to find all functions f of x, mapping real numbers to real numbers that have the following property for all x1, x2 in the set of real numbers, which is the inequality f of x1 minus f of x2 is less than or equal to x1 minus x2 squared. As usual, do pause this video here if you want to give this problem a try, and continue watching after trying it for a while. For this problem, the solution is to actually observe that we can make the left-hand side of the inequality to look like a slope expression, where we will divide both sides by the absolute value of x1 minus x2, so that we don't have to worry about any sign change as the absolute value of x1 minus x2 is non-negative. The left-hand side is quite familiar, and if it doesn't seem obvious to you, then let's take the limit as x1 approaches to x2. We see that the right-hand side is just 0. And observe that the left-hand side is almost the derivative of f of x at x is equal to x2, as it is the limit definition of the derivative of a function, but we don't really know yet whether f prime of x2 exists. However, we can do the same thing by swapping x1 and x2, since they are just dummy variables representing two real numbers, and we can get f of x2 minus f of x1 over the absolute value of x2 minus x1. Notice that because absolute values are non-negative, we can swap x2 with x1 in the absolute value. Then what we arrive at is the negative of the expression we have before, and both of these expressions are less than or equal to 0. This implies that we can actually combine these two inequalities into one, which is the limit of the absolute value of f of x1 minus f of x2 over x1 minus x2 is less than or equal to 0. By basic property of the limit, we can push the limit inside of the absolute value. And so the absolute value of the limit is less than or equal to 0. But absolute values are always non-negative. So if a quantity is both less than or equal to 0 and non-negative, it must be the case that the quantity is indeed just equal to 0. This means that the limit as x1 approaches to x2 of f of x1 minus f of x2 over x1 minus x2 is indeed equal to 0. And because this limit exists, it shows that the derivative of f of x at x is equal to x2 is actually 0. On the other hand, since x2 is chosen to be an arbitrary real number, this implies that the derivative of f of x at all real numbers is actually 0. And the only function with their derivative equal to 0 are all the constant functions, which is f of x is equal to c, where c is a constant. And indeed, we can verify that these functions work by plugging them into the given functional inequality, and we see that the left-hand side reduces to 0 and the right-hand side is always non-negative. Hence, we have shown that constant functions are indeed the only solutions. In this problem, what I like about it is that it uses some concepts in calculus to arrive at the fact that the derivative of the function is 0. This technique of solving problems relating to functions are not common when it comes to solving functional equations or math contests, and that's what makes it interesting in my opinion. Now if you have reached here, make sure to subscribe to the channel for more math videos, and click the video on the screen right now to check out the history of Coffin problems, and I'll see you in that video.